Hello, hello, everybody. It is 10:01 p.m. Central Time on Thursday, August 10th, 2017. Welcome into the Earthquake 3D Livestream. This is a place where we daily recap seismic events from around the planet, and we also issue semi-daily and weekly earthquake forecasts for new areas to watch for movement. So welcome in, everybody. If you're new here, of course, we do this on a daily basis. And we also issue these forecasts for specific areas for specific magnitudes to strike. I take the warning areas very seriously, guys. And we need to talk about something here right off the bat that just struck just a few minutes ago, about 30 minutes ago, here over in Italy. Now, if you know anybody who lives in Italy or in South Europe in the Mediterranean, please, please listen to what I'm about to tell you. About a year ago, we saw a deep earthquake in relatively the same location that we see this new 4.3 that I'm going to show to you on the map. This new 4.3 is raised high off the globe to indicate that it's deep down into the Earth. Now this is 227 kilometers deep, and it's in a location called the Tyrrhenian Sea. If many of my viewers may remember the Tyrrhenian Sea from last year, when a deep 5.8 struck, I got on and issued a warning for the next few days following that 5.8 to watch for a shallow 6.8 to 7.8. Now that would have put it at the largest earthquake in decades in Italy. And the next day, the largest earthquake in decades in Italy hit. It wasn't just luck. It was a deep earthquake that was pushing up on the underside of Italy, and it hit the plate boundary at Norcia, which is central Italy, where the big earthquake struck. Well, now we have a new deep 4.3, but it's in a slightly different location than the previous deep event last year. This is very close to land and very close to a few volcanoes. This may have a mitigating factor in the earthquake effect. The volcanoes may catch some of the upcoming pressure. I want you to imagine this like upwelling pressure from down below. I'm going to turn on something here. See this three-dimensional sphere surrounding the earthquake? I want you to imagine this coming up from down below the plate, pushing up on the underside. As it pushes up, look at the edges, where the edges go out to. Okay, it goes all the way out around Europe. We have to look to the plate boundaries that are affected by this. So the plate boundaries, we can go and check the USGS. Let's go see if we can get the USGS open on this. Is the USGS even reporting this deep earthquake? Oh, sigh. Hold on one second. No, USGS is not reporting this 4.6 earthquake in Italy. So if you're going to the USGS site, you're not going to see the earthquake on there. I don't know why they wouldn't report that earthquake, but the USGS does not have it. USGS does have the 5.3 from a few days ago. Let me get a display capture turned on so you can see what I see here. And looking at this, look at their map here. Okay, this is the USGS map. I'll back this out. Just take a look at the screen here. See the red line on here? Okay, they've got a red line going through here. Goes over to the east. See that? And it goes over to the west and up into Italy. Now that red line is the actual plate boundary. We have our red arrows over to the western side so you can see the area that we're talking about and indicates which way the plate boundary next to the arrows move. So while the arrows are technically over the Tyrrhenian Sea, the plate boundary is over eastern Italy. And Norcia is right in here, okay? So we're right in here in central eastern Italy. Well, we have to look in the area to the north by northwest of this new deep earthquake for a shallower, larger earthquake. How much larger? It can go 1 to 2 magnitudes larger than the deep event. Unfortunately, it's a deep 4.6, which means a shallow 5.6 to 6.6 could occur. Could occur. Now we hope for something less. We hope for a swarm. We hope for lesser activity. We hope that the pressure transfers somewhere else, but I want you to plan for a 5.6 to 6.6 just in case. I don't want you to panic. Famous last words. There's a movie, you may not know about it in Italy, but it's called Dante's Peak. It stars Pierce Brosnan. And in the movie, they're denying the buildup to a volcanic eruption. And Pierce Brosnan plays a geologist who is warning people, a volcanologist, who's warning people and they won't listen. Then, when the event is building and the town is assembled and in the stadium, the volcano erupts and he screams into the microphone. He's screaming in the microphone at the top of his lungs, "Don't panic." Now, I'll tell you, when you scream, "Don't panic," that's when people panic. So I'm telling you, please don't panic. I don't want to have the Harry Dalton effect, okay? But you guys need to be prepared for this. You need to be prepared for something 5.6 to 6.6 in the next 7 days from today, which puts it out 7 days from today, starting today, which is already the 11th overseas. So 11th, 12th, 13th, 14th, 15th, 16th, 17th. So the 17th into the 18th is when we'll watch for. So 11th to the 17th. And by the 17th, we should have a good idea of what's going to happen or what has already happened. You have to watch for this. You have to give it a few days' time. Last time, it took 1 day. The deep 5.8 last year caused a shallow 6.8 to 7.8, somewhere in between there. It went up and down on the magnitudes. They finally settled with a 6-something. But it was the largest earthquake in decades due to the last very big deep earthquake in the Tyrrhenian Sea. The only thing that could stand in the way of this are the volcanoes. If you see new big blasts at the volcanoes all of a sudden, then you might want to, again, you know, pay attention to the volcanoes for a minute. They might relieve some of that pressure. But that's just the start of this update, guys. That's just the deep earthquake in Italy that was going to cause new activity around here. And Italy is not the only one. You saw the sphere. The sphere of pressure goes all the way up into Romania, over to the east, and it goes all the way over into Africa, over into the west near Gibraltar. Up to the north, it goes all the way up north into France and Switzerland. I mean, what more can I say? The whole region should be affected by this, just like the last time, just like last October, when the deep one struck. Now that's, again, not the only activity that struck today. Look at the swarm that struck over to the east, indicating that more pressure is coming into Europe right now, regardless of the deep earthquake. Where's that pressure coming from? Well, we have to trace it all the way back over here to the West Pacific, guys. Several of the areas that we had warned were hit over the past day and a half. And look at what happened today. This to me just blows me away. Look at the 4.4 over at Taiwan, and look at the equal-sized earthquake, equidistantly spaced on the opposite side of the fracture zone at a different depth. So this earthquake here at 293 kilometers deep is a deep earthquake. It means this can cause a shallower, larger earthquake, 5.3 to 6.3, in a nearby silent area. Well, look at the arrows, look where the arrows are, and look what's to the north. 5.3 to 6.3 is coming back to the coast of Honshu again, guys. I hate to break it to you, but it's going to happen in the next 3 days or less. Next 72 hours. Okay? So we get two same-sized earthquakes, one deep, one shallow, on both sides of the plate fracture boundary zone. We look up to the north, and that's the Izu Ridge going onto the coast of Honshu, Japan. Down to the south, we have a new deep earthquake, a new deep 4.4. So we're in another deep earthquake event. This is 376 kilometers deep. A deep 4.4 can cause a shallow 5.4 to 6.4, most likely in the area to the west of the deep earthquake. To the south, we can expect a new 4.0 to pop back up in central New Zealand. Here's New Zealand. We look between Wellington and Christchurch for a new 4.0 earthquake. Christchurch was struck this morning by 3.8. So a 3.8 near 4.0 struck, that fulfills the previous forecast. If you were keeping track of areas that we named central New Zealand for a 4.0 earthquake. Look out a 3.8 and a 1 in a series of 2s. Add it together, that equals about a 3.9 near 4.0, just as expected, with 0.1 magnitude off from the expected magnitude. Up to the north, the new deep 4.4 means this is all going to repeat again. Also, next to the 4.4, there will be a 5.4. So there should be one magnitude larger next to the deep earthquake. And each time we've seen one right here, it struck to the east. Now, I don't know if that's going to happen again. That's been a rare occurrence compared to the other events, normally to the west. Just keep watch. All three areas are going to get hit around this deep earthquake. To the west, to the east, and to the south. This will also push all the way over to the East Pacific, and I'll talk about that in a second as well. But let's stick to the West Pacific for a second, see how they're raised high off the globe like this, the earthquakes, the three different sets. Okay, guys, this is an area about 3,000 miles across from west to east or east to west and to the north that's moving far down below. Then you get over here past Asia. See this? See another deep earthquake over here, right at the Pakistan-Afghanistan border with Russia and Kazakhstan. Then all the way over here to the west, over in Europe for deep 4.6. So really, it's from, this is just like last year. I hate to say it, but it's just like last summer. The antipodes, one side of the planet, New Zealand, the other side of the planet, Italy, both having deep earthquakes, which means half the planet is being displaced right now. And I haven't even talked about the volcanic eruptions or what happened on the west coast today. This is just what's going on here, the deep earthquakes. Now let's talk about what's going on up to the north. If you were keeping track of areas that we named the Kuril Islands going into Kamchatka, Russia to be struck by 5.0 activity yesterday. It was the halfway point. It was also next to the 5 that was off the coast of Honshu yesterday. And today, the Kuril Islands were hit right south of Kamchatka, Russia, just as expected. You can check that one off the list if you were keeping track of areas that we named to be hit. Going over to the United States, Alaska, check this out, guys. New 4.6 to 4.8 earthquake struck off the coast of California. Again, a new 4.6 to 4.8 earthquake has struck off the coast of California. We issued the warning for the coast of California yesterday. This is a 100% earthquake forecast hit for the location. And I issued the warnings based upon two things. One, the 4 that struck up off the coast of Canada yesterday when I was doing my update. Second, all the warning signs were there that something was building off the coast. We told you the slow slip had stopped down here to the south and it started to go quiet. And when the slow slip stops, that's when you watch for new movement to strike. And exactly as expected, when the slow slip stopped, now a new near 5.0 earthquake has struck off the coast of California. Right in the warned area, and I mean down to the point. You may remember. If you don't remember, go back and watch my last two videos on my channel for the past 2 days, and you'll see me zooming in and out on this area, talking about it, and saying we're looking for a upper 4 to 5.0 earthquake to strike. The reason we were looking for an upper 4 to 5.0 earthquake to strike this location is because of all the other 5.0 earthquakes striking the other locations, creeping down towards the United States. What does it mean for the rest of the West Coast? Well, guess what's going to happen now? The 4.6 off the West Coast should push to the east-southeast. In the next few days, we should see a new round of activity strike down in Southern California. Probably in the 4 range, maybe even a little larger. Where is it going to strike? Southern California between Los Angeles and Salton Sea, pumping operation to Volcano. Going over to the east, we have to issue a warning right now for a new swarm to return to Yellowstone and new larger activity to strike at the pumping operations back in Oklahoma and Kansas. Now, what does this mean for the people in Oklahoma and Kansas? Whenever you see a near 5 on the West Coast, you have to look for a near 5 in the Midwest. That's really what it is. The 5.1 last 2 weeks ago, the 5.1 struck pretty much right here, followed a few days later by a 4.4 here, the largest in months. It should repeat itself again. It should. Just like all the other locations, and we aren't even talking about the big earthquakes yet, we're just talking about the earthquakes that struck today. I haven't even mentioned what we're looking for in the next few days. But this fulfills the forecast for the west coast of the U.S. 100%. I need to turn on the 0.0 and greater feed so we can see the smaller earthquakes. Now, the smaller earthquakes will just show us the greater swarms that are happening and the greater unrest on the coast to let us know where is being hit and what to expect next. All right, now you can clearly see, okay, we've got a few stacks of earthquakes here, don't we? This is a noticeable change from where we were just a few days ago. Yellowstone has a stack of earthquakes surrounding it on both sides now, not just in the park, but on both perimeters of the park, going up to 3.1. We issued the warning for a new series of earthquakes to strike at Yellowstone going up to 3.1, and now there it is. Check Yellowstone off the list if you're keeping track of areas that we named. Over to the west, Mount St. Helens has a new stack of earthquakes. Just a small stack, nothing major, not a sign of an eruption, just a sign that the areas are being inundated with pressure. Now we have a 1.4 in Oregon. I'm wondering, is it an explosion or not? Yeah, haha, another explosion in a different location. Well, you know, you got a rogue tree terrorist that just keeps blowing up the trees. And that must be what's going on there. No, guys, we're seeing explosions being reported throughout. I don't even want to go there. Okay, never mind. We're seeing explosions turn up, and I don't know whether or not they really are. Let's just put it that way. Going down into California, all the signs that were there yesterday that we were going to get hit today, well, now all the signs that something hit today and is going to be pushing down the coast are there. So the big 4.0, 5.0 earthquake, upper 4, 5, struck here off the coast. It's going to push down to Southern California. You're going to see three things happen. Okay, this is just like clockwork. You're going to see pressure transfer down the coast. It's going to excite the volcanoes. Then you're going to see a swarm at the central portion. So at California going into Nevada near Mono Lake Supervolcano at North Long Valley Caldera, just south of Aurora Crater and Aurora Peak and Mud Springs Volcanic Buttes. This location right at the center of the screen is going to start to swarm big time. You're also going to see a new bigger swarm. So see how Yellowstone has ones, twos, and a three? You're about to see it go twos, threes, and maybe even a four. And people in the park will get a little shook up, and all the YouTube fear porn artists will come on and start talking about the threat of an eruption. And everyone will ignore dutchsinse, me, out here online, and they'll ignore the pressure transferring into the region. They'll ignore the 5.0 on the West Coast and say they don't know why it's happening. It's asinine, but I predict that if this all goes down as I see it, that's all going to happen in the next few days. Then, going down to the southeast from there, that's where we're going to see a new four strike between the LA pumping operations and Salton Sea Volcanic Buttes. So LA's got some pumping ops around the city, and then Salton Sea is the body of water down here to the east-southeast. It's a volcano, and in between there, there'll be serious stress put on there in the next few days. Over to the east from there, we have to warn a couple states. Now, the pressure's coming in from the west-northwest. Okay, so see the earthquake off the west coast again. See this? There's the 4.6. Now, I want you to take a look at the screen here really quick before I go any further. Here's the graphic of the craton. Look where the middle black arrow is coming in from the west coast, Northern California. I put this out years ago, this graphic. So it's been out for a long time. The arrow, look where it points to. It points into Colorado, right? Okay, let's turn this now off. Now you understand where the arrow points to. See the brown edge? The brown versus the purple? The brown versus purple is the interior portion of the craton edge. It just so happens to match up with the mountain ranges. Interesting, right? Now, look where the craton edge goes across. Yellowstone, right? Then it goes down across western Colorado on the front slope or on the western slope, then going down around through Texas and curling up into Oklahoma. Now, the green is really where the craton edge is. Now, our arrows are just a rough approximation of that. We don't want to cover it up like fully. We don't want the arrows going over it. You want to be able to see it when I'm waving my mouse around and talking about it. So the arrows are a rough match, but really you can see the yellow versus green where it comes up and then goes over and then goes back down. That's the spot where all the fracking operations are. Humans have stepped in along this range right here, going across Texas, going up into Oklahoma and across into Kansas. And it turns out that that's like a pressure release valve for this. So again, let me show you with my mouse. Here, right along the yellow edge, going up to the north, and then it makes a hard right, goes up to the north even more into New Madrid, Missouri, and then curls back down and around and goes across the southern states, curls back up the east coast, and back up across the New York border. Now, get a load of where the earthquakes are. Look at this. So, on the western portion, we're already excited going down into Utah. So that means Colorado, Kansas, Oklahoma, you're going to get hit. Pressure's coming in from the west-northwest. It's already hitting on the edge of the craton. It's going to excite things at Yellowstone, and it's going to excite things back at the fracking operations, most likely in Kansas and, I should say, western Kansas and western Oklahoma, right here near the border. Now, it gets hit each time. It's a pressure release valve. It's predictable at this point. Up to the east-northeast, look who got struck again. Small earthquake on the New York border with Quebec. Yet once again, another microquake. Let's go look it up. 1.4 at 4.1 kilometers deep, down below the eastern edge of Lake Ontario. Just a small earthquake, but, you know, again, it's a sign of pressure transferring across the plate. So 4.0 activity is expected to return to the Midwest, and we're expecting to see 3.0 activity return to the East Coast. Maybe even larger, guys. Maybe even larger. If you add in what's expected around the rest of the planet, it could go much larger. Let's talk about that for a second. Let's talk about the slow slip. Now, let me turn back on our 7-day feed. Now that you've seen the small earthquakes on the West Coast, we need to talk about the West Coast slow slip. Let's get all these other windows closed. There we go. So I told you, when the slow slip looked like it's stopping, that's when we issue our warnings for the potential of a coming large earthquake in the upper 7 to maybe even low 8.0 range, a very large earthquake. Now, yesterday, we started to see that the slow slip was going quiet. It was starting to quiet off. Today, I got on, and it really looked like it was starting to quiet off over the last 24 hours. And it has. There's only a spattering. A handful compared to where we were in the hundreds. Now, in the last 12 hours, even less. And in the last 6 hours, even less. And in the last 3 hours, obviously, 4 events in the last 3 hours. This is a huge drop-off from where we were. But I'm not shocked because the earthquake struck off the coast. The ultimate culprit that was pushing this all to begin with has been revealed. Now there's a new push taking place right now from the revealed hand of the earthquake. And it's going to re-excite things back up to the east-southeast. But the slow slip, what's going on with it? It's stopping. Even though we have all this inbound pressure, we have Mount Bogoslav that put off the blast, no new earthquakes reported up in Nunavut, and no major activity coming down past the 4.3 from yesterday. Well, guys, the zone is locked, loaded, it's gone quiet on land, and if we go another day, this is day two now, really day two of it starting to go quiet. If we get to tomorrow and it looks like it's even more quiet, I'm going to start talking about the actual threat of the earthquake striking soon, as opposed to just hypothetically, theoretically talking about what's going to happen when it strikes, when the slow slip stops. I will then be moving into the phase of talking about the slow slip stopped. How long are we going to have to watch for the earthquake to strike? That's where we're getting, and I don't like getting there because it's finally here, maybe. I hope not, but it looks like it might be here on the West Coast of the United States. And it means something above 7.7. It means something greater than what happened in 2012. We got lucky in 2012 when the 7.7 struck up here in the ocean between Vancouver and, well, Alaska, basically. And not many people even felt it, let alone saw the tsunami that was generated from it. But it did generate a few foot high tsunami. And it was in a rural area that, again, people weren't there to observe it, and I guess that's good, but we would want to see it strike in a rural area where nobody's going to get hurt. But the chance of it happening there, I mean, the West Coast is heavily populated, and it's a 650-mile stretch that's moved on land. So, like I said, in the last several broadcasts, normally, fours and fives, you want to see them. This is good. It's actually good to see fours and fives strike out in this area. And if these fours and fives were striking in conjunction with the slow slip happening on land, I would say, okay, the plate's moving. Good. Plate's moving, not much sticking pressure. It might be releasing in fours and fives, but we'd rather have a bunch of fours and fives than a big earthquake, right? A bunch of fours and fives that you can barely feel as opposed to a single larger event. Now, that would be ideal if the area was moving on land. But now the area on land stops moving. It's like one or the other at this point. I can't believe it. So now the slow slip is stopping. And I mean, just when I'm starting to get comfortable with, finally, we're starting to see some fours and fives And it's kind of, you know, easing my mind that, okay, it's releasing some pressure and I don't have to really worry about this becoming a big event. Now here we are in the slow slip dam stops. So we'll wait. We're going to wait a day. We're going to wait and see. Maybe there's some network outage or something. I want to give it a couple days. Here we are on day two, and we'll wait till day three, going into day four, before we start really talking about whether or not there's going to be this big earthquake. Now, speaking of big earthquakes and looking for big activity, all we got to do is go back a couple days to our sixes that struck in China. Well, look what hit after them. Look, guys, spreading out from the deep sixes. Look at the huge cluster of fours over to the west of here, and some of which are very deep, pushing up on the underside of the plate. Iran was hit as expected. Turkey was hit as expected. Western Turkey was hit as expected. This is all over the past few days. Now look what crept into over the past couple hours. I mean, it's so obvious. So we got a new deep 4.6. We got our threes and our fours. Pressure creeping across from our China activity, pushing to the west. This is a big increase. And let me tell you what, if we see a new 6.0 earthquake here in Europe, after we get these two sixes here, I think this will prove my case. I think it already has been when the first, you got to understand what happened. Many people might not know. See these two earthquakes? Would you believe they're related to one another? What if I told you they were 10 hours apart and professionals said there's no relation between them? Now the 6.5 struck first, and then 10 hours later the 6.3 struck. And then, the next day, a big-ass swarm broke out over to the west. Pardon my language, but I just have to say it that way because I'm sarcastic about the professionals denying that pressure transfers. And this is rated PG-13, in case you didn't know. So, this is YouTube. We try to keep it kid-friendly, but I'm trying to keep it teen-friendly, okay? You know what I mean? Like, I'm an adult here, and that really bothers me when professionals deny and literally ignore what's right before their eyes. So anyways, sixes turned into a swarm of fours, and now that's going to push over, and I believe the new deep earthquake in Italy is going to be causing a shallow five to shallow six in the next few days. I think you understand what I'm talking about here. Pressure is transferring around the planet, and it's transferring out from our deep earthquakes. So when we see clusters or swarms of deep earthquakes, look at the last several days. We went from no deep earthquakes, which it looked like we were stopping with deep earthquakes. I even said, it's been 2 to 3 days with no deep earthquakes. What's going to happen here? And then boom, 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 boom. They're raised high off the globe, and it's half the planet. Again, from Italy, across the Middle East, back across Asia, the West Pacific, Northwest Pacific, Southwest Pacific. The whole half of the planet pushed up on the underside down below. What do you think that's going to do to the rest of the plates connected to this? Take a look at the 5.0s and greater over the past several days. Now, you're going to see something here that, at least to me, stands out. Now, there's a few 4.9s on here because they're downgrades or they were originally reported at 4.9. See? Okay, look across the West Pacific. See how it spreads up to Alaska and stops right here. You know what's right here? Bogoslav Volcano. Now, if we take it down to fours, you'll see it's acted like a regulator of pressure. So, taking it down to fours, you'll see the United States was reached, but it was reached by the leftover pressure that wasn't released by Bogoslav Volcano. But let's get those smaller earthquakes off there. Again, look just at the fives. You see the whole half of the planet where the deep earthquakes are is displaced. The other half of the planet, four 5.0 events. So one half, nothing. Other half, everything. What's going on the other half? Well, from where the 5.3 is, all the way down here to New Zealand, there are deep earthquakes, and they're pushing up on the underside of the West Pacific. Then the areas attached to the West Pacific start to move. And look what's, see this huge cluster? Look what's next to it. Obviously, two big earthquakes. So this big cluster pushed first, then these two big ones hit. Then downstream from there, it goes right back over into Europe, recombines, and you get another large earthquake and another deep earthquake. It's like a cycle that carries itself on. So looking at the overall pressure transfer around the planet, I think you can start to get a good idea of which way things are flowing. and you can use the arrows. Please use the arrows like you would use a roadmap. Now let's talk about this roadmap. See where the deep earthquake is here? I told you at the start of the broadcast, it's going to go out in three directions. We've already talked about two of the directions. One, over to the west, a shallower, larger earthquake, 5.4 to 6.4, most likely going to strike in the middle silent point. Down to the south, New Zealand's going to get hit by that 4, remember? But over to the east, see the two big arrows? These two big arrows point back over to South America. In the last day, there has been little to no activity in South America except for eruptions. So there have been a few eruptions at Sabancaya volcano, but other than that, and Reventador, Sabancaya and Reventador both erupting, but no new earthquakes. Well, look where the two arrows point, back into Ecuador into Colombia, and the southern arrow points into the Chile-Argentina border. Both are going to get hit. This is not a 50-50 flip. Both are going to be hit by at least 5.4 activity, one magnitude larger than these deep fours. So the deep fours here are pushing over to the east, and they are going to impact South America like a wall. And that pressure cannot go over the wall, so it tries to go around it and underneath it. As the pressure tries to go around South America and underneath South America, you'll see new earthquakes pop off where the arrows point. Just so happens, this arrow also points to Reventador volcano, which is erupting right now, along with Sanjay volcano that erupted to its south just a few days ago. It's going to be big. With what's going on right now, don't kid yourselves, guys. In the next few days, we're going to see new, larger earthquake activity, just as expected. The China events, like we said, we're going to go up into the 6th range this week. It now has happened, and we're going to go up another notch. How do I know we're going to go up another notch? Well, there's been a new push. Do you guys ever ride a merry-go-round as a kid and have the big kids come out and start spinning it faster and faster? And you get four big kids, and they're spinning it faster and faster, and eventually the kids just fly away, right? Yeah. Well, I saw that example used in something recently. Well, again, this is a good example. Each one of the deep earthquakes that's pushing in on this is like another hand on that merry-go-round. It's going to turn it faster and faster, but we're not turning faster and faster. We're pushing up more and more. More hands on the deck. More people lifting something. There's many examples we can use that you can understand. This is a greater amount of force over a larger period of time, over a greater distance. So greater force, greater time, greater distance equals greater output in the end. That's what it means. How much bigger? 1 to 2 magnitudes larger than the deep earthquakes. Now look where the deep earthquakes are, and look in between the deep earthquakes. That's where our big earthquake activity will start to strike. So 2 magnitudes larger will start to develop out at the middle point between these deep sets. And there's a lot of deep sets. So we've got one right here at Papua New Guinea. We've got another one over here in the West Pacific, going north in between Japan and all this other mess. Or again, it's a triangular position here in between the three. You go down to the south, you've got another one in between our two sets of quakes. In the next few days, each one of these is going to be getting hit by a shallower, larger earthquake than the deep earthquakes surrounding it. There's so many areas, I'm gonna have to almost do a separate series of videos tomorrow warning each individual location as these spots are popping off. Let me name Japan. Let me just give you a great example here in Japan. Kuril Islands was just hit, as expected, right? By a 5.0 earthquake. Now that 5 was related to this 5 right next to it. The reason this was a 5 and this is a 5 is because of the deep earthquakes that were deep 4s. So deep 4s called shallow 5s. Makes sense, right? Okay, so now we have to look in between the current sets of earthquakes for the next round to hit. So find the halfway point between these sets of earthquakes. Let's start to the south and work our way north across Japan. There's only really 2 to 3 zones that I'm seeing here. So between the 4.4 here and the 5.0 here. Between those two brings us right down in the middle. You don't just do a straight line. You actually have to go over the contour of the plate boundary. So it's not just a as the crow flies situation. It's actually a little bit of a bend in there. The halfway point brings us right in here, south of Sakurajima on Tsunamis volcano, almost directly. Now, Suwanizajima erupted last week. So are we looking at a new eruption at Suwanizajima? I don't forecast eruptions. I'm going to forecast for the earthquake. The earthquake should be 5.1. Now, how do I come to that conclusion? 5.0 plus a 4. If you take a 5.0 plus a 4, it might go to 5.04 or a 5.05, which I just rounded up. That's, I mean, again, once you get to 5.05, might as well just round it up to a 5.1. So it should be in the 5.1 range, striking in South Japan. Not that big of a deal, but it is enough to shake things up and cause an issue. But we have an added-in punch coming in. From where? From the deep 4.3 over to the east. The deep 4.3 on its own can cause a shallow 5.3 to 6.3. So you have to add the two together. Now that we're getting a little bit complex. So we have to add the 5.3 plus a 5.1 or a 6.3 plus a 5.1. Well, if you add the 5.3 plus the 5.1, you get a 5.4. If you add the 6.3 plus the 5.1, you get a 6.35. So in other words, a 6.4 maybe, or 6.35. In other words, we're looking for a 5.3 to 6.3 still. In light of the activity on both sides, the halfway point, again, the halfway point is the spot that's going to be hit. Now, in between this 5.0 and the 4.3, that's the Izu Ridge. Well, guess what's at the halfway point here? Nishinoshima volcano. Just so happens to be right at the middle point. It just so happens to be the other volcano that erupted 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago. So is Nishinoshima going to erupt again? Yes, most likely. With the new deep earthquake pushing up on the underside, and it's at a fulcrum point, but I forecast earthquakes. So it's the same sized earthquake we're going to look for, since we're talking about the same magnitudes. Both sides are going to be hit, should be hit by the mid-range 5 level in the next few days. Up to the north, we have another silent zone. This 5.0 on one side, this 5.0 on the other. The halfway silent point is right here north of Hokkaido, or in North Hokkaido. So we look for a 5.0 plus a 5.0, that's a 5.1. So 5.0 plus a 5.0 equals a 5.1. Or technically, you could say a 5.2, because you might be adding in a few 3s and 4s that we're just not seeing here on this feed. So we'll put it at 5.1 to 5.2, just like down to the south, guys. So it's pretty much the same sized earthquake on both sides. But we got lucky because we're dealing with the same sized earthquakes on both sides. If you get earthquakes that are of other different magnitudes on opposite sides, it gets a little bit complex trying to add them together, but it's just still rough addition. 10 threes equals a 4, 10 fours equals a 5, 10 fives equals a 6. You just add them up point by point. So let me give you another example. Let's say you have three different 3.0s. Three different 3.0s equals 3.3. Simple, right? Four different 3.0s equals 3.4. Five different 3.0s equals 3.5. Just 3.0s as an example. We'll do 4s as an example. Four 4.0s equals 4.4. Five 4.0s equals 4.5. Six 4.0s equals 4.6. Do you follow me? That's how you add them up. So once you start adding up the earthquakes, rough addition, magnitude scale, rough addition. I can't believe it that works, but it does. It's a miracle that it works. Anyways, there you go. That's the earthquake activity to look for in the West Pacific. Now, over to the west from there, we do have one more warning spot over here in Nepal. In between the 4.1 and the swarm of 4s here that was caused by the 6, there's an area sitting high and dry. I mean, come on. Now, I don't know if Nepal's protected right now. I don't think so. There's no special protection. You guys are in the middle of probably one of the biggest events to happen since the Nepal event. Are you going to get hit? Yes, you are going to get hit. The only good news I have for you is that those sixes are going around you over to Europe. It's not good for Europe, but it is good for the people in the Middle East and in Asia. So here, you're going to get hit only by a combined total of the fours on either side. So you have a 4.6 and a 4.1. That equals 4.71. That's on one side. On the other side, you've got a 4.4 and a 4.2 and a 4 and another 4.2. Let's add those together. That equals about a 4.8. So a 4.8 on one side and a 4.7 on the other. You add those two together and you get into 4.98 or a 5.0. So basically a 5.0 is coming, most likely on the north side of here, but we have to warn on both sides. So North India going into China, this is Nepal right in here, the tiny country, it's a very sliver of a country. And when a 5 strikes in here, it can be felt across the whole region. Time frame on that, 72 hours from now. Keep watch. Could be an upper 4, but I'm leaning towards a 5. Now going back over towards Europe, oh, hold on. New 4.2 earthquake just struck down below Crete. And this is shallow. This one's shallow, guys. Oh boy, here we go. Still rocking and rolling. You're coming in from two directions now. You got a direction, a shallow earthquake just popped up at Crete. This is going to push to the west-northwest, back into Italy. Two double whammy. A double wham. Now, I'm wondering, are these even real? Is somebody playing around on the feed? This is happening every night when I'm getting ready to get off. This is starting to get a little freaky. I don't know what's going on, man. Oh, look, the New Madrid seismic zone just got hit. My own neighborhood. New Madrid seismic zone just got hit. Now it is getting freaky. Now we are getting freaky. This fulfills the forecast we issued yesterday when the 3.7 struck and the day before for the New Madrid seismic zone. We issued a warning for my own neighborhood here in Missouri. And I talked about Missouri for a second and talked about how we all need an earthquake plan and how, again, this is a sign that pressure transfers across the plate. Now 2.0 just hit at following those threes over here in the Midwest or in the Plain States. But going back over to Europe, look, a new 4.2 pushing into Italy on its own could cause a 4. So a 4.2 coming out of Crete, pushing into Italy, we've seen it happen dozens of times. So at this point, there's a double threat. One threat for a shallower, larger earthquake, 4.6 causing a 5.6 to 6.6, and a 4.2 incoming that could cause its own 4.0. So regardless of the deep earthquake, you now have to watch for a 4.0 earthquake on top of the other earthquake. So even if the other earthquake fizzles, you're still getting a 4. Even if the deep earthquake has no effect and just goes to the volcanoes and explodes a bunch of volcanic eruptions and goes away in pressure or transfers out of the region or even misses and I get it wrong, there's a 4.2 that just struck at Crete. And that means a new 4 is going to be rolling in. Into central Italy in the next couple days. And I say couple days, I mean it should be not that long. This week, next few days, let's go beyond a couple, let's go to a few, which puts it to like 3 to 4 days at the most. Seems to be happening an awful lot lately, guys. When we're talking and things start striking, it's almost like the combined psychic energy of the entire population is focused in on the earthquake and causing it to happen. I got to apply Occam's razor. We're just the luckiest people on the world. Not in the world, because there is no inner world. We're the luckiest people on the world. And I would like to say also to my viewers, guys, you are awesome for putting up with all the crap and still sharing the information. Look, every area that we talked about this week has started to move or has already been hit, one of the two. There isn't one that wasn't hit. This past week was a 100% earthquake forecast. I don't normally get those. Normally, it is at 75 to 80%, pretty much right on. But this past week, I had to make a bunch of videos to show each location. Some people said, oh, you're exaggerating. Why are you making? Other people were like, why are you making so many videos? I'm like, dude, I'm making a video each time a location that I named was hit. So there it is. Now again, Crete has been hit. Italy has a new deep earthquake. You know what that means. If we get lucky, it'll be a swarm. But I don't like to rely on luck. I want you to not be scared, and I want you to be prepared. Don't be scared, be prepared. If you're in Italy, you know, and I want you to know, I'm going to focus on this again. Please listen. Please. If you're in Italy, the warning signs show up days beforehand. Here we are. We are in the day to days before a potential large earthquake. It's not wise to ignore a storm. If you see a storm coming your way, don't ignore it. Your storms, your seismic storms, come from Greece, Turkey, Iran, all the way back over here. Your storms start here in the West Pacific. Then your seismic storms press your direction and come across Asia, the Middle East, and back into Europe. Now you have a new push up on the underside of Europe itself. That new push should cause shallower, larger movement. The reason there is shallower, larger movement, a good example from 40 in our chat room here, used a lever as an example. And I really like that example because leverage, we all understand how levers work, that a lever can move something of greater weight or with minimal force sometimes, depending on the angle of leverage. And I believe there is some leverage involved with these deep earthquakes, that when they push up on the underside of the plate, there is a greater translation in power force up at an angle, which would explain why, for instance, when the Tyrrhenian Sea is hit here, the area at an angle to the north is hit at the plate boundary. It may be an explanation, and it may be an explanation why it happens in each location that way. And you get 1 to 2 times greater force, 1 to 2 magnitudes greater force, which is 10 to 100 times increase in power. 1 magnitude is a tenfold increase in power. 2 magnitudes greater is a 100-fold increase in power. And it just so happens that there's some leverage math that could be applied to this and probably come out with some answers. I don't have time for that right now, but maybe one of my viewers does. Okay, have a plan. Do not be scared. Use the roadmap. The roadmap shows you which way the pressure transfers. If I lived in Italy, now here, listen. If I lived in Italy from Campobasso all the way up to Milan, I would warn my friends. You don't have to use my name unless you want to blame me. You can blame me if nothing hits. I don't have any money and I'm not going to jail, but you can blame me. You can razz me and give me a hard time if nothing hits. But why blame me? This happened already once. It happens elsewhere. If it doesn't happen in Italy, we will be lucky. There will be a mitigating factor that may stop it. But I don't like to may and mitigating and hope and no. I want to tell you when I see a storm forming. If the storm goes away, so be it. But if I lived in Italy, I would be prepared tonight, tomorrow, the next night, and the next night. I would be prepared for the next 3 to 4 days. Me, personally, if I lived there. So what does that mean? It means I would secure the cabinets. I would have my bug-out bag, my preparation bag, by the door. I would call my friends. I would call my family. I would tell them, hey, we got another deep earthquake down below the Tyrrhenian Sea, just like last year, last October, remember? And they'll say, huh? Yeah, oh yeah, I remember. I remember the big earthquake. And you'll say, no, no, no. The deep earthquake that hit the day before, that gave us the warning that something was coming. And there'd be a few people then would say, oh yeah, I heard about that online. Yeah, so I'm warning you now. And if nothing hits, well, good. But I don't want to not warn. If I don't warn you, I gotta sleep at night. I've got to sleep at night. I've got viewers there that have sent me awesome, heartfelt gifts, handmade items, pasta. They've sent me food. They've sent me beer from Italy, my viewers who live there. I love them. They're awesome. They're cool people. So I'm warning them, if not anyone else in the country, and you're embarrassed to share my information. You should not be embarrassed to share my information. You know why? Because California just got hit, as expected, twice in the past 2 weeks with the expected earthquakes. And this is rare. We haven't had any 4 and 5.0 earthquakes in months. I'm not bragging. I'm just telling you, my accuracy rate is 80% normally. 80. There, that out of 10 areas, 2 are wrong normally. Last week, my accuracy was 100% for the first time that I can remember. 100% accurate. I'm going to remember this week for a long time, and I'll always remember it because it's the week I moved out to the country. The week I moved out to the country was the week I nailed it for 100%, is what I'll say in the future. Until it happens again or until I flop hard. But until that happens, the pattern is holding true. This is tidal. We can forecast the tides. We can forecast the wind. We can forecast the sun. You can forecast the stars. You can forecast ocean currents. You can forecast animal migration patterns. You can forecast seismic events. And I've explained how to do that. If you want to know in detail how to do that, watch my How to Forecast an Earthquake video or read the post. They're free. They cost you nothing. I don't even think I have ads on them. I don't know. I'll have to check and see. Might have an ad on it. You can just skip through it. I don't care. Watch it. Read it. Repeat it. But be prepared for it. Don't ignore it. You would not ignore a big storm. A big storm coming at you, big black clouds building on the horizon, lightning and thunder, tornadoes coming in the distance. You hear about other towns that have already been hit. You wouldn't ignore it. You would probably get your camera out and start taking pictures of it coming your way. That's what I'm doing right now. I've got my camera out, and I'm taking pictures of it coming your way. I'm telling you about it. You can ignore it if you want. Ignore and hope for the best. Sure, fine, okay. I wouldn't. I would prepare. I would prepare for a 5.6 to 6.6 in this week, just in case. And after this week, we cancel the warning. Okay, so we don't have to look that long. And I'm talking slow so the people in Italy can translate and understand what I'm saying. I do not take the warning lightly when I'm talking about Italy and deep earthquakes. 200 people killed last year. And we put out warnings twice. So August and October, 200 people killed. October, thank God, no one killed. Injured, yes. Killed, no. Because they got the warning. August of last year, what day was it in August that Italy got hit last year? I don't recall. Hold on. Let's go look it up together. 200 people died in this earthquake in August last year. Italy, August 2016. Yeah, there we go. August 24th, 2016, a 6.2 magnitude. There we go. I'll read it to you. This is Wikipedia, but good as just any. An earthquake measuring 6.2 on the moment magnitude scale hit central Italy on the 24th of August, 2016, 3:36 a.m. Epicenter was close to Accumoli, with the hypocenter at a depth of 4 plus or minus 1 kilometer. Well, I mean, what can I say? Here we are in August again. Be prepared, just in case. Much love, guys. Tanto amore to my people over in Italy. Elsewhere, I didn't talk about this. Dang it. Central America. Let's finish up this broadcast right now. Central America, you got hit. Next to Fuego, next to Guatemala, we issued the warning for 5.0 activity to be striking. Remember we said talk about El Salvador and South Mexico? All right. Well, you know, again, I can't beat my chest over this stuff, guys. It happens almost every day at this point. Next to the volcano, a new 5.0 earthquake struck next to Fuego in South Mexico next to Guatemala, shaking up the whole area, and again, 5.0 earthquake. 4.3 striking south of Popocatépetl, and I haven't even talked about the volcanic eruption feed yet today, which is something we need to go look up right now. Let's quickly look that up. Take a look. Oh, whoa, whoa, whoa! Put on the brakes! Sakurajima just erupted. Did it erupt earlier, or is that the only one? Hold on. Hot damn, Sakurajima just erupted, guys. Sakurajima, let me show you where it is. Look at this. Wow. Wow, a volcanic blast to end this one up. Look at that. I haven't checked the feed at all today, guys. I had the internet installed earlier. First time I've checked it. Take a look. Look at that. Sakurajima just popped up no more than how long ago? 2017-11 at 1320 Z. Is that right? 1320? Or 320? 320 Z. Okay, 320. So 30 minutes ago, it just blew right here. Now we were looking right here for Tsunamis. Instead of Tsunamis, we got Sakurajima. There you go. What? A 4.6 just hit India? The Indian Islands? Yep. There you go. New 4.6. Hey, didn't we issue a warning for this island? Anybody in chat? Dang it, it's all running together now. I had too many warning areas. I don't have this one written down either. I'm pretty sure we issued a warning for here. I'm going to have to go back 3 days ago and watch. Anybody? Anybody in here? Anybody remember? I got the chat room open. I think people can see it here on the screen. Hold on, let me get it turned on. Anybody remember this? It had to be 3 or 4 days ago. We issued the warning for the island here, and I talked about it, how it was an island that belonged to India, and it doesn't matter. Anyways, a 4.6 just hit there. It's not that big of an earthquake. It's just proof pressure's transferring out. I wonder if Cinnabung erupted today. Let's go see. Did Cinnabung erupt today? If it didn't, then it probably allowed pressure to transfer out. And that would explain why they... Now there's one blast on here. Flight level 122. Well, that would explain why it's smaller. Cinnabung didn't let pressure transfer out. And if Cinnabung had not erupted, it would let the 5.0 pressure out, and we'd see 5s up here instead of 4s. But Cinnabung is capturing, or like a gatekeeper, only allowing a certain flow through. And again, that brings us back up into Myanmar. New 4.6 just striking there now. Now look at the progression of earthquakes going across the area. Look at that. See that? It's spreading out from where the deep earthquakes were. So the deep earthquake's at the center of this, and it's pushing up on all sides, going out towards India right now. Okay, yeah, okay, now we've got people, two people in there. 2 days ago. It was 2 days ago? Oh my God, that was 2 days ago? It seems like an eternity, man. Oh, yeah, you know what? I've just been on here nonstop just watching all these areas pop. It's just like I really need to keep a spreadsheet at this point. Normally, we just do it by the video, but at this point, there's so many areas getting hit. When it gets excited like this, it's not always like this, guys. When it gets excited like this, it's almost to the point where I need either a team of people or a spreadsheet or something to keep track of it. Because just naming a few areas, normally we're talking 10 areas. This, in this case, for the past few days, God, we're at like 30 areas, I want to say. There's been 30 areas that we've named in the past several days that have all been hit. You can go back through the videos. It's incredible. So I know we're getting under the skin of the professionals because, man, they've got to be scratching their head at this point saying, where did we get this wrong? How could this guy on YouTube? Oh, la, 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 la. Hey, guys, you can just settle this all right now. I'll take the Nobel. You can just send it off. I don't want it, actually. Money brings problems. Just, you know, I'll take a trophy. You can send me an American Geophysical Union trophy. I'll put it up on the wall. That'll be my little medal of honor. All right. So the time now is 11:01 p.m. I want to thank everybody who shared the information. Thank everybody who shares the information over to the Europeans. When the earthquake strikes after this deep earthquake in Italy, we are going to at least be relieved to know that we shared the information with the people who live there. And if nothing hits, I'm your fall guy. go ahead and point back to me and say, look, and I'll point back to the deep earthquake from last year, just so you know. I mean, I'm pointing back to last year's example as the reason I'm warning you now. There is no other reason I would warn you other than it's a deep earthquake and it already happened once last year in August. So August and October, two different events, both had deep earthquakes, but the October event really had a big event that followed it up, and that's why I'm worried now. Because it's the Tyrrhenian Sea. I mean, if this was a deep earthquake somewhere else, I mean, down below Algeria or somewhere rare like that, then I would be warning Algeria. If it was a deep earthquake below California, I'd be warning California. So the reason it just so happens to be a repeat event in the same location as last year, down to within a couple months of it. It is absolutely amazing. Thank you to everybody who's been sharing the information. Finally, to all the people who like my work, if you like my work, there is a link down below to contribute to my Patreon. Patreon is a way to compensate me for my work. It's not like a fundraiser, so I'm not asking for anything or anything like that. This is, I will do my work every day, or almost every day, and you guys, if you like it, can contribute on a monthly basis. And most people do $1 to $5. So it adds up. We've got well over 350 people. We're nearing 400 people, and many people are very generous. You guys are so awesome. Thank you. And you've made it so I don't have to accept corporate sponsors, so I don't have to sell anything unless I want to sell a Dutchsinse t-shirt, and so that I don't have to rely on YouTube, who cut everybody out if you're an alternative researcher or you don't belong to one of these corporate networks. You got to understand how YouTube works. They want you to join these things called multi-channel networks, where multiple companies control hundreds, if not thousands, of channels. And then you report to those companies. Those companies then report to YouTube, and it gives you special protection and preference and all kinds of other stuff. And all my competition, SO, Dabu, BP, all these guys that are on YouTube that have the same size channel as me. They're not my exact competition, but they're the same size. They all joined the networks at some point. Okay, I don't know if they're still part, but they joined at some point and belong to these networks. I never joined and never will. And because I never joined and never will, I also turned down multiple hundred thousands of dollars worth of financing offered by a hedge fund firm. I don't know what they are. They offered to finance my operation. Very kind people. Nothing wrong with them. But I turned it down because I don't want to be on anybody's beholden list. Not that it would make me beholden to them, but it would just, I don't want to have that axe over my head of having to produce something or make something to sell or do something with someone else's money. So you guys collectively are compensating me to be here. Otherwise, I would be out there in the world doing trees and doing the carpentry and doing the physical manual labor that I did before I did YouTube. Thank you for all the people who've contributed to that. I don't have very much else for you. The Duchess says thank you to everybody who wished her a well-wished birthday yesterday. She had a good time. We had a good time. It was incredible. I now have high-speed internet here at the house. You should notice a clearer resolution on the screen, and it should be a little bit faster. At least it shouldn't be choppy. I mean, it might be a little bit more choppy, but I don't know. It should be running good. We've got a high-speed connection now, and this is great because I also have the camera that I just got. Here, you know what? Hold on. Take a look on the screen here. Whoa, hold on. There we go. Hey. Now my camera fell over earlier when we were doing the cable work. So, and the lighting's messed up because I had to take the lights down. So bear with me here. But the camera that I got, check this out. Now here's one. Here's one of them. Okay, this sucker's going to go up outside where the current crappy camera is that you guys have been looking out to see the lake. This one does full night vision up to 150 meters. So we're going to be able to get, or 100, oh, I'm sorry, 150 feet. So we're going to be able to pick up night vision all the way down to the lake at night, see the deer and the wildlife. That's going to be great. And then I've got a pan tilt zoom camera that's coming in, and we're going to get that going. That's going to be cool, and we can control it to look down at the lake and look at the steam on the lake and the sunrise and the sunset. We got pelicans and storks that land on our dock. That's going to be incredible too. And then finally, once I verify those two work well, we're going to get another camera for weather tracking and star tracking. So we'll be able to do star tracking, meteors, fireballs. We've got great night sky out here, and we're going to utilize that as much as possible. It's going to be great. And if you guys are going to be around on August 21st, we're going to be doing the solar eclipse here. Right where I'm at, in a location called Marthasville, Missouri, which is between St. Louis and Columbia, we are right underneath that middle cone of where the solar eclipse does the full thing. And even if it's cloudy outside, I'll still have the cameras out, we'll have the microphones on, you'll be able to listen for the woods to see if any nighttime creatures show up, and also we'll be able to tilt the camera and look up. I also have the special lens that'll allow me to zoom the camera in on the sun. We're going to have to tape it to the outside of the camera, but that's fine. So we can actually get a good shot of the sun. We should be able to zoom in on it a little bit. I don't know how good it's going to look. It's not going to be NASA quality. Which actually is good, because it'll probably be better. It'll be real. All right, anyways. Word up, guys. Much love. Much love. I'm going to save this as a video on my channel so that you guys can share it with the rest of the world. I would appreciate it if you would share it with the people in Europe. I hate to say it this way. I don't want to make it sound too important. It's YouTube, I understand. But I would feel that there are lives at stake. You can leave my name out of it. You can just warn them and say this. There is a deep earthquake down below the Tyrrhenian Sea, south of Rome, out in the ocean. And it's pushing up on the underside of Italy right now. Now, we hope nothing's going to happen, right? Hope nothing's going to happen. But be prepared for 1 to 2 magnitudes larger than the deep earthquake, which was a deep 4.6. So a deep 4.6 can cause a shallow 5.6 to 6.6. That's why you warn the people. And you tell them, don't worry, we don't have to watch out for long, only this week. And if anything else changes, we'll be addressing it on a daily basis. I'm watching on an hourly basis at this point, but we'll be addressing this on a daily basis, day by day, until the warning time expires or until the earthquake hits. Anything else? Tanto smore. Tanto smore? Yes. That's what they say out west when they're having a campfire. No, that's how you say much love. And poliagape. Poliagape? Poliagape. To the people.